What's up, everybody? Fantasy football, at least the fantasy football season, is coming to a close. And you may have noticed you're only getting the fantasy footballers two times a week. I get it. Those tears, they are falling down your face. They are streaming. You are saying, what happened to the footballers? Well, at least you get the two shows a week. And on top of that, do you want more nonsense?
Yes.
We have. Thank you, Jason. We have another show. It's all comedy. So the football part is out, but the nonsense, the hijinks of the fantasy footballers, it is there. It is called the Spitballers Podcast. We give terrible advice at things. We answer really funny would you rathers. We do fun fantasy drafts. Like this past week, we just took songs that you think would scare somebody out of your house. It is a very good time. The shows come out every Monday. Start your Monday with just a little bit more nonsense. Let's get into this show.
Welcome to the Fantasy Footballers Podcast with your hosts, Andy Holloway, Jason Moore, and Mike Wright.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the podcast, the Fantasy Footballers Podcast, if you're nasty. It's me, the host supreme, Mike the Fantasy Hitman, right? Joined by my best friend, my best virtual friend, my friend from down the street, Jason Moore. What's up, buddy?
What's up, best friend?
Oh, we are the best friends.
Oh, playoff football, football that you can watch without just having all selfish thoughts all the time about how my picks win, how my fantasy team's doing, and how my opponent is playing. This was great. You could just watch football, root for great action, which there was. There was some really fun action this week.
Our Band-Aid was ripped off week 17 when the Arizona Cardinals did not make it into the playoffs. So we had nothing to root for or hope for. Now, there's fans of other teams that have their weekend was not very good. I don't know if you are following the Pittsburgh Hive on the socials. They are very sad.
Oh man. Well, I don't understand why, but you want to talk about ripping a Band-Aid off. That sucker was,
that
was ripped clean. That was the string tied to the door when you're getting the tooth out, just slam that door. It's over.
So the score of the Steelers and the Browns, it got a little bit closer towards the end. If you were playing any DFS, Big Ben came through with a monster game despite four turnovers. The Saints and the Bears game, it was, the actual gameplay. How much of the Nickelodeon broadcast did you tune into, Jason?
100%.
Yeah, you were all in on it.
Oh, yeah. I mean,
look,
the game was pretty boring, if we're being honest. I mean, you know, as Bears games tend to be. So I enjoyed the broadcast. I mean, certainly at times it was a little too corny, and their obligation for how many hits of Nickelodeon comps must have been like they get paid a bonus at 1 million.
and they hit the over.
Yeah, and they got paid two bonuses. they stack, but yeah, no, I really did enjoy it. I thought it was great. My youngest son came and sat next to me and played on his iPad pretending to watch football.
Nice.
So it was a real bonding moment.
My daughter made it through about a quarter, which is that's far more football than she has ever watched. I liked it too. I like to explain it to the kids, get them all involved. I thought there was going to be more zany hijinks with animations and things, not just, you know, like the cutting in and out of the commercial break. The slime zone was fantastic.
Oh, that was awesome.
Not fantastic. The Whims touchdown drop, which that changed. If he catches that really easy catch,
the whole game is different,
and we may be having a different story. But
I feel like we're already getting into these games. You want to just hop into the weekly rewind here?
Yeah, we might as well.
Weekly rewind.
Well, we're back in the weekly rewind. I had kind of done, instead of the quick question, I just wanted to get into the games. All right, so the Colts took on the Buffalo Bills. It was an excellent game. To start off the playoffs, we could not have asked for a better game. Josh Allen and the Bills did end up vanquishing their equestrian foes, the Indianapolis Colts, by 3 points, but it came down to the wire. Zach Moss, running back for the Bills, he was carted off. He had an ankle injury. He might miss the rest of the postseason, unfortunately. Did you have any takeaways from that game?
It was nice to see, and this is a repeating theme of this weekend, but it was nice to see the young quarterback who faltered in his first attempt get back and play well. Like the improvement that Josh Allen made this year,
sure,
was incredible. A MVP candidate, won't win, but you know, he was in the conversation. That's how much better he got. And you saw last year that, you know, he had some talent and really imploded when the big show hit. And so you had worries, you had questions. I'm sure Bills fans were like, can we keep what's happening in the regular season going on when it goes to the playoffs? And that was what I was super happy about. Josh Allen, Stephon Diggs, the offense just looked great. I don't think the Bills defense is good enough to get all the way through these playoffs,
yeah,
but
we'll see.
I loved seeing the offense play so well.
I have a confession. Partway through the first quarter, I realized I was rooting actively and strongly for the Colts. P. River, footy award winner for the nickname of the year, Philip Rivers. I like Philip Rivers a lot. I think that Philip Rivers has a Hall of Fame worthy production profile. Like, he's been in the league long enough. He has tons and tons of the longevity records, but he doesn't have a Super Bowl win. So I don't know. Philip Rivers is going to be one of those guys when the time comes, of the argument will be pretty heated of, well, look at his numbers, and then Super Bowl people will go, well, yeah, but he never won a championship. So I started hoping through that first quarter that we could see Philip Rivers get there and get a ring, but because that could be his last game.
That is, I think there's a real good chance that's his last game. He's a free agent now, and the Colts have to decide. I mean, the reality is they might not be able to do better than Philip Rivers, but at the same time, they kind of see where their ceiling is, and that's not what the Colts are going after. They're not going after being a playoff caliber team. They want to, you know, win a Super Bowl, and I don't believe Philip Rivers can do that.
He turns 40 in December. It's incredible that he's been playing that long. The Rams and the Seahawks. Another wacky game where the Wolfman, John Wolford, was actually the starting quarterback for the Rams. Their backup was starting because Jared Goff was dealing with his broken thumb that had been surgically repaired. Apparently, they made the decision that the Wolfman was the better option, and he got hit with a stinger. I don't know if he was concussed, but he got one of those, him sliding head first and a defensive player running right into his head. He got knocked out of that game pretty much right at the beginning. So then Jared Goff had to come in, and Jared Goff, the backup. For a guy with a broken thumb, I thought that he looked okay. My biggest takeaway from this game, it wasn't something that a thought out of nowhere. It was just cementing to me that something, Jason, we had talked about on the Footcast, last week's Footcast for our extra episode for supporters on jointhefoot.com. Cam Akers going to be my dude. I like Cam Akers has skyrocketed to my favorite sophomore running back. I think that
I feel like you're not allowed to have him because it was my idea. I brought him up.
Dude, we are hand in hand, and
okay, there we go.
The pixie dust is on us. Faith, trust the pixie dust, and we are just soaring through the atmosphere. I am all in on Cam Akers. The volume is there. The offense of the team is there. His durability is a little bit suspect. We've already seen him get banged up multiple times in the season, but we've seen if he's there, Sean McVay wants to give him the work, just like he gave Todd Gurley the work a couple years ago.
Great with it. I mean,
right.
He's been phenomenal. He's been absolutely their best running back. He was someone that coming into this season, you know, we all loved Cam Akers. He was easily one of the top three running back prospects. And after the draft, he was my number one after the two, you know, after Clyde Edwards-Helaire and Jonathan Taylor. The season got off to a slow start, but man, the system, we know how valuable it can be for fantasy. I think Cam Akers is going to dominate next year.
It was another one of those rookie drafts where immediate opportunity, and I'm reflecting out loud for myself personally. I think the immediate opportunity was, this year was too much. It was factored in too much because Clyde Edwards-Helaire was the consensus number one player. If he wasn't number one, he was number two, and you had Jonathan Taylor number one. But for me, scouting those running backs last year, I liked Edwards-Helaire, but he was like my fourth or my fifth favorite running back. The landing spot and the fact that he should be the immediate starter, though, had me take him at the 101 and pass up on Jonathan Taylor, who was my favorite running back of the draft class, knowing that the landing spot for him was fantastic. You just didn't know when it was going to happen. Now, for Taylor, you could not have predicted that it was going to be week one when Marlon Mack goes down with a torn Achilles. But and you could just keep moving that down the line of taking Clyde Edwards-Helaire because you want him this year one. Okay, we're past that now. We're into the sophomore year. Cam Akers. I would rather have Cam Akers than Clyde Edwards-Helaire. J.K. Dobbins, that's a little more questionable, but he is now very, very close in the rankings of my heart for Clyde Edwards-Helaire, and DeAndre Swift will be moving up as well. So it's just an interesting little, you know, sidetrack note here for me, thinking back of last year's dynasty draft, just so full of great players. Do you still move forward with taking the player who has the immediate opportunity, or do you take who you think is the better player, but you're going to have to wait a year?
I'm usually going to take the player who has the immediate opportunity. It didn't work out this year, but it wasn't just opportunity. It was opportunity plus the team, plus being, you know, on the Kansas City Chiefs. And look, we just both, you know, talked about our love for Cam Akers. It was very difficult when, you know, we came up with our rankings for this show. We're doing the top 24 guys. So we did. And I put Clyde Edwards-Helaire one spot ahead of Cam Akers.
Really?
Currently. That's how I currently have it. I think Clyde Edwards-Helaire is still going to have a much better future than his rookie season.
I agree with that.
You know, he was taken off on a lot of third downs. I don't think you'll see that as he becomes a veteran. And, you know, you saw David Montgomery rookie year be just really disappointing in a very similar fashion to Clyde Edwards-Helaire. And then, of course, it clicked. David Montgomery figured it out this year.
Right.
So I'm not anti-CEH at all. Other notes in this game with the Seahawks and Rams, a realization that I had was, and this should be a huge compliment to Seahawks fans, man, I was so thrilled that they lost. I mean, I was just ecstatic because it's crazy, right? We're Cardinals fans. Both of these teams are NFC West rivals, right?
Yes.
Yeah. I mean, the Rams were just in the Super Bowl, a couple years ago. They're a great team. But the Seahawks are the ones that I look at as the bully of the division. Like, and so that's a huge compliment to the Seahawks and to Seahawks fans that I root hardcore against you.
We have some great news for the Seahawks fans, though, that Pete Carroll has said that Brian Schottenheimer, the offensive coordinator, will be back next year, and the primary focus going into 2021 will be run the football more often and more effectively.
Yeah, in that same conference call, he discussed how he thought Schottenheimer did a – well, here's the deal. You saw the beginning of the year, the great offense that the Seahawks had, right? Pete Carroll, when Russ started turning the ball over a lot with all those throws, Pete Carroll asked Schottenheimer to change the offense to have fewer turnovers, and Schottenheimer did that. I think Schottenheimer isn't necessarily bad on his own in the sense that he wanted to open it up and, you know, was kind of told to reel it back in. And then now going forward, though, that's really scary for fantasy purposes. Sure. You know, next year they are going to be an establish the run team for sure.
Yeah, and I was thinking of things we had to look at and try not to overreact to, but that 5 weeks in, having that conversation where DK Metcalf had taken over the league, and it was the question was asked even on this show, like, do you move DK Metcalf up to your number one player on the board? Because he would move up to your number one dynasty wide receiver. If I have the 101 in a dynasty startup, I take my number one wide receiver.
Right.
So, I mean, those questions are where it looked like that wasn't slam dunk, an easy thing to say 5 weeks in. Now 17 weeks out, you go, he's in the top 10, but I don't know where it would go.
We came up with our 2021 ranking, so we will reveal where Metcalf slots in for us later this episode.
Indeed. The Buccaneers took on the Washington football team. What felt like was about to be a trouncing and a blowout. Taylor Heinicke played his Heine off. He gave us the show. It wasn't enough to get Washington the win, but that was definitely something by the young quarterback from Washington, showing that he's got some stuff that he can do on the football field. What did you have any takeaways from that game, Jay?
My takeaways were what a great story Heinicke was. It was awesome rooting for him, but also how the Buccaneers offense is really starting to click. They put up 31 points in the playoffs in Washington against the Washington football team, who is great. Mike Evans, what a man. I mean, goodness. I thought he was going to miss multiple weeks with that knee injury, and then he goes out, plays hobbled.
I totally forgot about that.
Plays hobbled and dominates. Antonio Brown dominated. Chris Godwin dominated. I mean, they are looking like a real fun story, and now I believe we get the old man bowl, right? Isn't it Brady Breeze? That's going to be awesome. That was my big takeaway here. Not much else in that game.
They mentioned on the broadcast yesterday, this will be the first time that we have two 40-year-old quarterbacks battling in the playoffs. That's pretty wild. We'll get into wide receivers, but Jay, I need a sneak peek. Sneak peek.
Okay.
Who's your top Tampa Bay wide receiver?
Oh, Mike Evans.
Okay. He is for me too. I wasn't sure where things would land out. The Ravens and the Titans. Lamar Jackson was able to shake out that nonsense of Lamar Jackson can't win a playoff game. Just absolute bullcrap narrative. They took it to the Titans. They got their revenge from last year. Derrick Henry. He was the Yeti for a couple of weeks, and then I guess the full moon went away.
The Clippers, and they shaved him. And I don't know if you've seen a shaved Yeti, but it's a pretty freaky sight, and it's not good. The Titans were up 10-0, and they looked like they were
dominating,
really in control of this game. And the Ravens clicked; they turned it on, which is fantastic news for both my preseason and before the playoffs Super Bowl pick of the Baltimore Ravens. More so, my playoff challenge is very Ravens heavy, so I needed to make sure that the Ravens continued on.
Very nice. Derrick Henry, 18 for 40.
Wow.
18 for 40. Now
he got injured at one point in the game, and then missed a series, came back out. I don't know if that factored in or not, but I'm not, for next year's purposes, he's fantastic.
Right. A.J. Brown is 100% certified. That dude, 6 for 83 with a touchdown. He had, at times of this game, he looked completely unstoppable. Lamar, he got the legs going, had a huge 50-something yard rushing touchdown. And then Jason, this is now a trend. This isn't just small cherry-picking the sample where we want to and where we don't want to. Hollywood Marquise Brown.
He's a great player.
7 for 109 with 9 targets. We know the Lamar passing pie is very small. It was 24 attempts and 179 yards. Well, when 9 targets and 109 yards go to Hollywood Brown, he's going to be good for fantasy purposes. How many straight games now of relevant Hollywood Brown have we seen? Are we up to six or seven?
Seven. His final six games, he was never outside of the top 36. Three times as a top 24 wide receiver. So he's been really good, really consistent. I still will learn a lesson from this last season and not bank on talent in such a small pie, if you will. But I do love seeing him show the talent that I saw that made him a my guy, which was devastating for me this year because,
yeah,
I mean, he was someone that you dropped. You almost had to drop him because
I dropped him.
He was so irrelevant the first half of the season, but it's nice to at least be able to say, this is what I was talking about. The potential is there, but yeah, I'll learn my lesson.
J.K. Dobbins, 9 for 43 with a score. But right behind him, Gus Edwards, 8 for 38. I project Gus Edwards will be back with the Ravens, and it's going to be Dobbins and Edwards. So that when I'm looking at, you know, the sophomores breaking out, taking the jump, Dobbins has a very strong Gus Edwards holding him back at least a little bit.
He hasn't held him back much. I mean, the end of the season, I will say this. He held him back in the sense that most of the time he was like running back 15. That's
what I mean.
He wasn't a complete and utter dominator, but obviously he can. The last week of the season, he was the running back 3 against Cincinnati. But if you just look at what that does for you over the course of that time, he had to be a top 10 running back over the last 6 weeks of the season.
Yes, great. I'm saying held him back in terms of Cam Akers touched the ball 30 times in the game against the Seahawks, and that was not the case for J.K. Dobbins.
Yeah.
The opportunities get taken away a little bit by Gus Edwards. All right, and then the final game, we kind of already talked about it, but the Browns, the Steelers, holy freaking goodness, Nick Chubb is just such a delight. If you aren't watching Cleveland Browns games, you're missing out. A gift from the heavens was given to us football fans to just enjoy and watch and revel in what this man can get done on a football field.
Yeah, and then Kareem Hunt comes in and just looks amazing as well, scoring multiple touchdowns. The running game is great. This was, if you didn't see the beginning of the game, it was 28-0 by the end of the first quarter. It was all based upon, it wasn't like the Browns were doing anything super special. It was Big Ben and the Steelers kept turning the ball over. They would get it and start a drive, and then they'd say, "Hey, Browns, you want the ball right here? You got it." And they did that over and over and over until that game was just completely out of reach. You know, they were literally trying to make sure the clock's running in the second quarter. You just don't usually see that. So it was awesome. It was fun. Fun to watch for a team that has struggled for so long.
Yeah. Next week's matchup, we got the Rams and the Packers, the Ravens and Buffalo, the Browns take on Kansas City, and the Tampa Bay Buccaneers versus the Saints in the battle for who's first in line at Old Country Buffet at the end of the game.
All right, before we get into the 2021 rankings, essentially the top 24 players.
Yeah, these are locked in. These will not be changing.
No way could they change. I mean, we are prognosticators of the top variety, so we are clearly going to write this in permanent marker. But we want to thank today's sponsors, and we want to thank Simply Safe. Simply Safe is really, it's very simple. If you need home protection, you should use Simply Safe. We use it. This is a personal endorsement from history. Brooks uses it to save all of his millions. I believe I saw Elon Musk just recently overtook Brooks in wealth, but it's close.
Yeah, sorry, Brooks. I know you were a little heartbroken over that.
Yeah, that was rough. The reality is Simply Safe has great, high-quality arsenals, sensors, cameras. They have an easy setup. It's 30 minutes, do-it-yourself, super easy, perfect 24/7 monitoring. No long-term contract, no hidden fees or installation costs. It's really a great product. Right now, The Foot Clan can get a free home security camera when you purchase a SimpliSafe system at simplisafe.com/footballers. You also get a 60-day risk-free trial, so there's nothing to lose. Visit simplisafe.com/footballers for your free security camera today. That's simplisafe.com/footballers.
And ladies and gentlemen, we know that when you're confident, you don't settle for anything less than 100. Are you the kind of person that takes everything up to 100? How about your hair? Is your hair sitting at 100? Are you at a 90? You want to get to 100? Head & Shoulders gives you up to 100% dandruff protection. That means if you use it regularly, you can prevent up to 100% of visible flakes and get the hair that looks 100% amazing. Jason, this weekend, I took my couch sitting all the way to 100. There is a new divot in my couch cushion because I was taking it all those games. That Buffalo game, man, that game was definitely taken to 100. Do you have anything you took to 100 this weekend?
Oh, man, I took to 100 a garage shelf building. I mean,
whoa,
you
yeah,
know, yeah. 100. I'm a yeah. Man.
And look, I can't believe you got your garage done, man.
Well, I mean, you. I wouldn't say done.
Oh, well, I thought you said you took it to 100.
I did take it to 100. It takes time, my man. It's going to be 100 today as well.
And make sure you get up to 100% protection of those visible flakes when you're using Head & Shoulders. Take your hair up to 100 with Head & Shoulders, available online at Walmart.
The Fantasy Footballers Mock Draft.
All right, Jay, why don't you explain what we're going to do?
Okay, before I explain what we're going to do, we did miss a pretty big piece of breaking news that happened right as we started to record. The Eagles,
their management took something up to 100 today.
They have let Doug Peterson go. A couple years ago, Super Bowl head
Be
coach.
Be free!
And now they're saying you are responsible for how bad we were this year. And he is gone. What do you think about that? Good move, bad move?
It's very difficult to move on from a coach who just won a Super Bowl a couple years ago. And honestly, I'm not 100% sure where this leaves all the quarterback controversy. The reports from this morning, and we are recording on Monday, the reports were they're going to have another meeting. The brass is going to have a meeting with Doug Peterson. If they are not aligned in their vision for Carson Wentz, then Doug Peterson is going to be let go. I don't know what the vision is. I don't know if the upper management still wants to hold on to Carson Wentz. I don't know if they want to trade him away and get Jalen Hurts involved. There's reports of a locker room stuff of Peterson losing the locker room throughout the season, and then the kind of the crescendo moment of that was when he put in Sudfeld for the second half of the game, giving his team, his players, a worse chance at winning, even though, I mean, there's nothing on the line, but they want to win, and you want a coach who's going to give you the opportunity to win. So I'm not sure where we are, but it's going to be a wild ride in this offseason as Philadelphia tries to figure out if Carson Wentz is their guy. And then if Carson Wentz is the guy, you just say, hey, Jalen Hurts, thanks for what you did, but you're right back to the backup.
Yeah. I mean, I think all that makes sense. I'm not a fan of the move. I think Doug Peterson is a good coach. I don't think he forgot how to coach. His staff has gotten worse. We've talked about that. Frank Reich was there as, you know, an offensive assistant when they won the Super Bowl, or maybe he was the OC. But Doug Peterson isn't a bad coach. And so now you have to go and you have to replace him. And it's not always going to be better. I thought that the Eagles were idiotic when they let go of Andy Reid. But this puts to me a good coach on the market where there's a bunch of teams. Like, there are good positions to be filled right now by head coaches.
Yeah.
So that'll be an interesting name. I'm sure he'll land a head coaching spot this off season.
Really, you think he'll go, right?
I do. I think he'll go. Yep. I think one of these teams will offer him a head coaching position. I mean, it worked for when the Eagles fired Andy Reid and the Chiefs said, okay, I'll take him.
We almost had him in Arizona. That was painful. We are Arizona. When there is a juicy free agent of any kind, Arizona is always in second place.
Mm-hmm. All right, so as far as the top 24 players for 2021, what we are doing is we are going to do a pseudo mock draft here, Mike and I. We're not drafting teams per se. We're just going to go back and forth and say, if I was on the clock and these players were gone ahead, who would be my next player drafted? So we can basically get our, Mike and I's, consensus top 24 players as we project for the 2021 season. It was actually, it's really good that we're doing this because in preparing for this show, I didn't realize, you know, how much information and looking forward surprised me when I was making my rankings and looking at everybody's individual season. It's nice to get that break from the weekly grind and then mm-hmm. look back at the whole and realize, you know, where you think things head in 2021.
All right, so I have drawn the first pick. My man won the footy award for the poopiest pants. Didn't he won it, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you, Brooks. Thank you, Brooks. But it's not going to deter me because when he was on the field for his three games, it just everything was still there. It proved that he is the best. It proved that he has lost nothing. He unfortunately had an injured season. It happens all the time. I will take Christian McCaffrey, number one from the Carolina Panthers.
Yeah, that makes sense. You know, you could be disappointed at the injuries and all that, but he was fantastic. And,
would you
and
take him one?
I have him as my number one pick, yes. You just look at what – I mean, Mike Davis was valuable when sure. Christian McCaffrey was out. But when Christian McCaffrey was in, I mean, think how good Dalvin Cook was this year. Averaged 22.6 fantasy points a game. It was outstanding. In the three games we saw Christian McCaffrey, he averaged five more points than that. So, you know, he's obviously got a only three-game sample size, but not really because we've seen it the entire previous season. Christian McCaffrey would be my number one pick as...
And the team has let me know it was not the poopiest pants award. He was the Fantasy Reaper Man of the Year.
Oh, there it is. There it is. So we did a week five draft, kind of like what we're doing now. After a month into the season, we drafted who we would draft for the rest of the way, and we're going to kind of remind us who we took as we take those picks. So the first player we took in week five was Alvin Kamara, if you remember how on fire he was. Obviously, at that point, it wouldn't have been Christian McCaffrey since he was
hurt.
Injured.
Okay. Okay.
All right. So I've got the next pick. And I am taking the running back one for this year. I'm taking Dalvin Cook. I think that's
all right over Kamara.
I am taking Dalvin Cook over Kamara. You know, some of this when you're looking at 2021 is a little bit projection. I don't have a strong enough feeling to know if Drew Brees will be back or not. But the fact that that is a 50-50 proposition says Dalvin Cook, I know what his team is. It's Dalvin Cook. You know, they're going to hand the ball to him as much as possible. Does look like they lost Gary Kubiak, which I think stinks for the running game. Kubes is a phenomenal mastermind of an offensive line run scheme. But Dalvin Cook's a special talent, just like Alvin Kamara. And I think Alvin Kamara will definitely take a step down if Breeze leaves.
Okay. Who did we take at number two? Who's revealing it?
Well, I would say the host. So I'm going to make you do it.
Ezekiel Elliott. Wow. Wow. Oh, that was still during the Dak time, I think.
It was. Dak
all
went
right.
down.
Didn't that make
in,
sense?
Dak went down in week five, and actually, you know, this is. Well, we'll get to Zeke soon enough.
Yeah.
Or maybe we'll see where he is.
You're right. Maybe
we'll see where he is in our rankings. But I have thoughts on Zeke. That we will get to.
At number three, I'm going to take Alvin Kamara. Jason's right. We don't know if Drew Brees is going to be back, but what I like is the usage of Mr. Kamara here lately, and that would include three straight games of 20 plus carries. The guy that averages 12 to 13 carries or so a game and then really makes up for that in the passing game, they have started to feed him the ball, which is a nice sign. Not that I expect him to be fed the ball 23 times on the ground next year, but that is part of an offense they can go to if Drew Brees leaves. I like it. I believe that Sean Payton will figure it out in that Alvin Kamara. I'm still going to take him at number three. Is he number three for you, Jason?
He is number three for me, yes. Okay. I think those will be the three top picks next year. But there are at least two other guys who will be in the argument, in the conversation. Okay. And so for the next pick, I'm not going to take someone who I think will probably could very well sneak back into the top three. I'm actually going Derrick Henry. I'm taking the Yeti over Saquon Barkley because there are questions with Saquon. The injury, look, I believe Saquon comes back. I think he's going to have a great year. But there are the injury unknowns, whereas there's nothing unknown with Derrick Henry. I know exactly what he is. I know what his team is going to be. I know he's going to be great down the stretch. I know he's going to touch the ball 30 times in every victory and 22 times in every loss. So I'm confident taking Henry very high, even though I don't usually take non-pass catching backs early.
The difference between Derrick Henry and those top three guys is Derrick Henry will give you two, maybe three games throughout the season where it's just doesn't happen. It's a good run stuffing team, and they're able to get up a couple scores, and they have to abandon the Derrick Henry offense, just like we saw in the playoff game. It happens to Henry a couple times, and he doesn't have the pass catching role. I mean, he'd be better if they threw him the ball more, but he doesn't have that role in that offense to help keep him afloat when those things happen. Okay, and then the player we would have taken. The player we would have taken third back in week five was Aaron Jones. The player we would have taken fourth was Christian McCaffrey, even though he was hurt. This was back when there was optimism that McCaffrey.
Hope. There was hope that hurt you. Yeah, it was.
It's the hope that kills you.
That's why he was the Reaper Man of the Year, because.
Yep.
You know, Saquon, you cut him on your. You know, you just let him go to the waiver wire, and you make additional plans, and you move on. And with Christian McCaffrey, you always thought, I just need to get 1 week out of a guy, and then Christian will be back. All right, you're on the clock here.
At the number five spot, I am still not out of my tier where I would look at Devontae Adams, who's going to be my number one wide receiver. So I'm still going to stick with a running back. And like you, Jason, I would have taken Derrick Henry five.
Oh, yeah?
At four, I'm sorry. And here at number five, I am still not taking Saquon Barkley.
Oh, really?
And this is prognosticating at the extremes because I need him to stay on the team that he is already on. I'm talking about impending free agent Aaron Jones, running back for the Green Bay Packers. I would take him right here, assuming that he is back on the Green Bay Packers.
Sure. I mean, obviously we saw in the beginning of the year how unbelievable Aaron Jones, you know, was as a talent. I think towards the end of the year, it was a little bit more disappointing, more finishes as, you know, in the running back 20s, you know, where he didn't really electrify. Do you think that was due to injury or, you know, he had the calf injury, I think, in week eight that kept him out?
He had the calf injury. I mean, and he still finished, you know, awesome.
It was a running back five on the season.
Right. And even through the stretch of where you were a little bit disappointed of him, he still only finished outside of the top 24 one time. And he was still excellent. And the only difference to me is the difference why we're talking about Aaron Rodgers as, you know, like the quarterback draft pick of the year. It's touchdowns. Last year, the numbers for Aaron Rodgers last year, they were down a little bit, but it was the touchdowns that had seemed like they just vanished. And that's because Aaron Jones got them all. And then you had the regression of return back to the pendulum swinging that Aaron Rodgers was the one who benefited from all the touchdowns. I think we'll see it, you know, swing back at least a little bit towards Aaron Jones, who still managed to be the running back five on the season, even missing two games and not putting up the touchdowns that he did last year.
All right, that's interesting. I have Aaron Jones. I mean, that all makes sense. He's awesome, and the offense is great, and the touchdowns could go up, assuming he is a Packer.
Yeah.
I have him down a tier. I've got him behind my top wide receivers.
Okay.
You know, we had, even when he had more touchdowns the previous season, he had stretches where he hurt you, and
certainly.
I just don't like how willing they are to say, I don't need to give you much work today. I just hate that. All right, so I'm on the clock. I'm going Saquon here. He's my running back five, my overall player number five. So I'm getting him at a value. You assume he should be back. The timeline is good because his injury was so early. He'll be healthy, and obviously we know what he can do. He's been, you know, the number one running back in fantasy football before. He can catch the ball. He's game script proof. I don't love this offense. That's obviously a massive negative for a running back if they're in a bad offense, usually, unless your name is James Robinson.
Right.
Unless you're an undrafted rookie free agent. But yeah, I would take Saquon here, and I think some people would take him higher, especially, here's the thing, as we get closer to the season next year and draft time, and Saquon's just been an active part of training camp and, you know, in the whole offseason program, and he's looking great and all the news is good. I mean, I could see him being the consensus ADP pick three.
Sure. I don't disagree with that. All right. My pick number seven here. Oh, and number six, we took Dalvin Cook back in the middle of the season.
Whew, that was a steal.
That was a steal of the draft yet again. So pick number seven, I am at the threshold here where I would consider taking Davante Adams, but the running back who I want, just because I want this guy on my team. Sometimes fantasy football, you take the player that you want and you want to root for, and this guy, he is a bad, bad man. I'm taking Johnny Taylor from the Indianapolis Colts.
All right.
He finished the year on an incredible, just a tear, giving you a glimpse of what he can be. No, I don't think Jonathan Taylor turns into a full three-down bell cow and they abandon Nyheim Hines. Like, he's going to be in a timeshare, but he's at least in a timeshare on a run-first team. I don't know who the quarterback is, but they can hand the ball to Jonathan Taylor and that incredible offensive line. And like I said, I want to root for Taylor, so I'm going to take him here.
Wow, I have him as my running back seven. So I thought I was going to be much higher on him than you, but here we are at pick seven, and you take JTT. I love it. I have him, and here's where we will have the discussion. At pick eight, the player I have actually ahead of Jonathan Taylor is Ezekiel Elliott.
Okay.
He is not so dropping that far. I have not abandoned.
You're keeping the faith.
I am. I look. The reality is this with Zeke. He was great in the beginning of the year. His first 5 weeks when Dak was there, he was exactly what – he was drafted as a top three guy for a reason. He was a top five running back over the first 5 weeks. Dak goes down, then Dalton goes down, then Dalton gets COVID, then eventually Zeke ends up with his own injury, and the whole rest of the season – was a cluster for him, terrible, and you want to know, is he washed? Is he done? When that wall hits with running backs, it's just over. I do not believe it's over. I think Dak is back in charge, and Ezekiel Elliott will be right back to being a three-down workhorse. I mean, don't get me wrong, Pollard will still be involved, but I'm not off of Ezekiel Elliott. I think he has a great 2021 season.
He's not as high in my list as he is for you, but I agree that Zeke could be the steal of the back of the first if he's actually dropping there. I do think that Tony Pollard will be used more next year than he has ever been used before. They've seen enough of Pollard to know that trust in him and his big playability, which means you got to give him a couple more snaps and a couple more attempts throughout the game. Our next pick. So we're up to pick nine. Pick nine. Yeah, all right, this is where I do it. This is where I take Davante Adams, wide receiver from the Green Bay Packers. I don't know if you can get better than last year with that target share that he had and the touchdowns that he came through with. But it is complete. The mind meld between Aaron Rodgers and Davante Adams is it's now Jordy Nelson level of they just know what the other person is going to do. And Aaron Rodgers has no problem throwing the ball every single time to his favorite player because he wants someone who he feels confident is going to get the job done, and that's Davante Adams. So I will take him here, even with a bunch of juicy running backs on the board.
Yeah, at pick nine is where I picked Davante Adams in week five. He, you know, I think he was probably the first wide receiver off the board. He is my number seven overall pick. I have him ahead of Jonathan Taylor and Aaron Jones. I would take that a little bit earlier, but at this point in the draft, he would absolutely be my pick. I'm moving to that position ahead of all the other running backs left on the board. And when that transition happens for me, which is at pick seven, it goes Davante Adams followed by Travis Kelce.
Oh,
so is how high
hot take alert
Kelce is. I mean, he's been the number one. He's been the number one tight end every single year for half a decade. He was unfathomably good. There's no reason to believe he slows down yet. He's healthy. He's awesome. And he was such a difference maker. Everybody who had Travis Kelce pretty much made the playoffs because you just have a huge point advantage. And unlike the quarterback position where it's so easy to replace them, you can get great quarterbacks at the end of the draft. At the end of the draft at tight end, you're getting garbage. You're exchanging your 15
I hope you like your garbage.
Fantasy points for two fantasy points. The gap is huge. So once all those running backs and Davante Adams are off the board, I'm going Kelce.
Oh, that is – I don't mind it. I do not mind it. So your level of confidence in Travis Kelce still maintaining that level of dominance is supreme heading into next year?
Yeah, I think if he takes a small step back, I will still not hate having drafted him, having had him on my roster. It's going to take a collapse or obviously an injury, but that could happen with every player you possibly take there.
So he will be – He will still be 31 next year.
Yeah, and tight ends play. Yeah,
they certainly can.
Older. They're not the speed juke cuts and incredible athleticism that gets them open. They're strong, bigger than you guys. He's going to get open in a zone and then try to tackle him.
All right, there are a couple running backs who I am looking at right here. But let's have some fun. This was where I will launch off to my hot take, and it was already I had already set the foundation for it at the beginning of the show. I will take Cam Akers right here.
Oh,
I will take the bell cow.
Brother.
I will make the bet that he is the three down guy, that he is the goal line guy. To me, I get it. Back when Todd Gurley was at his peak, Todd Gurley was the best running back, or you want to make an argument, whatever. He's a top three running back, but he was a top three running back in an offensive system that was specifically designed to get players away from him. Sean McVay, the way that he lines up his wide receivers and uses motion, he gets defenders out of the box to make the run easier. He's already showing that again for Cam Akers. He's already giving the volume to Cam Akers. I think we are those questions of which Rams offense are we going to see? Is it 12 personnel? Like no, we don't have to do that stupid Cooper Kupp argument with Tyler Higbee anymore. We don't have to make that argument anymore because it's going to be Cam Akers. I'm going to take the shot right here, even though it seems a little unconventional to take him this early, but I believe long-term in Cam Akers.
It is ahead of where I have him. But if we knew for sure coming into the season that, Sean McVay says this is Cam Akers' role, he'll skyrocket up for me. I'm going to stay at the non-running back positions here. This is kind of the tier where I've got some other players. I'm going to go with Tyreek Hill. Tyreek Hill's been phenomenal year in, year out. He's got Mahomes. He's got Andy Reid. And outside of Devontae Adams, he's the next wide receiver that I would select.
And I'm going to follow that up. I'm going right back to running back. I'm going to take Nick Chubb here. His fall can stop. Nick Chubb is just, he's going to be right here somewhere, right at, you know, maybe the end of the first, the beginning of the second round. He feels like the best sort of consolation prize. Like if I'm in the draft and I'm at pick 11 and I'm hoping, you know, that I get Cam Akers, but I don't, you know, then I'm taking Nick Chubb. It's locked in. He's going to be fantastic, but he has a Kareem Hunt touchdown vulture problem.
Yeah, no, I get it. This is that's the player that I would have. He's 12th on my overall board, so I think he's good value here. This is the player that I've got him ranked here, and I love this guy. I love him.
Okay.
But I do. This is the first one I go, ugh, really? Would I do it? But I'm gonna stick. I'm gonna stick with my rankings. It is a wide receiver.
Is it a wide receiver who played on a new team this year?
It is a wide receiver who played on a new team this year. And you could, I don't know, there's two guys that it could be here based on that. You have any other questions? No, it's not our team.
Is it a team that with red? Done that one first.
Well, it's a team with red and blue. It is.
Is it a team that is still playing in the playoffs?
It is, in part because of him and what he's done for this offense. Stephon Diggs has obviously shot up everybody's fantasy football boards as he was, I believe, the wide receiver 3 this year. He was exactly what you hope for in all positions. He was consistent every week and gave you monster games. That's the dream. And while I do think that this is peak, I think this is ceiling, what we saw this year. It's very likely that Josh Allen regresses in the touchdown department next year. And even if he stays great, we'll just take a slight step off the gas. I still love this offense. Love the knowledge that he's the number one guy and the rapport he has with Josh Allen. I'll take Stephon Diggs here.
All right. The player who I'm okay if you want to take this running back over Nick Chubb. You know, the DNA of how I play fantasy football makes me want to, because I want pass catching running backs. I'm going to take Awesome Eckler right here and feel fantastic about it. We saw what he could do with the rookie. You have the change. The change is coming. There will be a new coach for the Los Angeles Chargers, and we aren't sure who that's going to be. Either way, Austin Eckler has the contract that says, I am the man here. Please continue to give me the ball.
Yeah, I get it, and that's who I have in my rankings as well. It's funny, I keep taking wide receivers, but mixed in while you take running backs are what my rankings are as well. So I'm going to go back to wide receiver, and I'm going to take the other guy who changed teams, who is on a red team, DeAndre Hopkins.
Okay. No Michael Thomas.
Still no Michael Thomas. Part of that is Drew Brees and the question mark of who the quarterback is. And part of it is Kyler Murray. Kyler Murray's still a very young quarterback. He's still, you know, in the realm where I expect his passing to get better next year as he, you know, enters his third year into the NFL. So if that happens, it's only good news for Hopkins, who is the clear number one for him. So I'm happy to take Hopkins there.
And I have two running backs here who are just neck and neck. I'll take the other one to help keep this conversation moving. Because he should, honestly, this guy should be drafted higher, which sounds insane. We're only 16 picks into the draft, and I'm talking about a running back who should be drafted higher, but we aren't sure. We are not sure because he's an undrafted superstar, Jason.
Oh, my gosh. Wow.
James Robinson from the Jacksonville Jaguars. Even Jason had forgotten about
Robinson. I hadn't forgot. Look, I absolutely hate where I have him.
I don't know what to do with it. Yeah, I hated it, and I said, screw that, I'm going to move him up, and I still hate it because what James Robinson was able to do on a bad team with a bad offense with terrible quarterback play was be one of the most consistent running backs in fantasy football, still hit ceiling games, and now he gets the famed Sir Lawrence coming out of college. James Robinson, if he holds on to the role, How is he not a top 10 running back?
If he has the same role he had this year, he will guarantee be a top 10 running back. I have him as my running back, brace for it, 19.
Oh, boo.
Running back, boo. 19. I couldn't get myself to – because here's why. We saw this with Philip Lindsay, the undrafted rookie free agent who burst onto the scene, was a top 12 guy his rookie year. And the fact that this is not, there's no investment in him, and there will be a massive investment, obviously, the number one pick into Trevor Lawrence. They just kept giving him the ball over and 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 over to infinity. They're not going to do that this year. They're still going to – I think he projects to be their starter, but I don't actually think that they're going to have that same offense. They're going to try to install a new offense for Trevor Lawrence and a new offense for an undrafted rookie. Like, I've got, you know, DeAndre Swift and Miles Sanders and Josh Jacobs and Gibson, all these guys ahead of James Robinson. But I will say this, the one player when I made my rankings that I hated the most, as far as where I put them, is James Robinson. All he did this year is ball out, be a top five running back, and then I put him at running back 19. It's sad. All right, I'm sticking with wide receivers.
Oh, okay, perfect.
I am taking Michael Thomas. He's right behind DeAndre Hopkins in my rankings.
Yeah.
He's as good as it gets, obviously the number one wide receiver 2 years ago, the number one coming into this season's draft. I did not realize.
It's not exciting, though.
It's not exciting.
Which sucks.
I didn't realize. I heard the broadcasters, I believe I'm going to say this stat correctly, that he had only caught 9 passes on the season from Drew Brees.
Yeah, that makes sense.
I mean, I didn't realize it was that low of the amount that those two played together. So, yeah, he could have a bounce back. If Brees is back, this could be the best value in the draft.
He certainly could bounce back. Now, when I made my running back rankings, I did not have the information that Doug Peterson is gone.
Mm.
Doug Peterson is gone, and he was just a wart on every time you felt like you could be happy and play Miles Sanders, because you would get the super random Corey Clement has not seen the field today. Yeah, but we're on the goal line. We should put Corey in over Miles Sanders. Like just absolute crazy stuff that would happen and committee the situation way more than you want to. So I'm not going to take Miles here, but he's going to be very interesting now, depending on who the team brings in and the offensive philosophy of the new regime in Philadelphia. That could be very exciting or very worse.
It could get worse. It could get worse because that's not the coaching staff that brought him in, that drafted him. But it does seem there was a clear division between coach and GM. They obviously work together, but Hugh Laurie's going to want his picks to play well. I've got him quite a bit lower.
Dr. House?
Yes. Hugh Laurie, general manager of the Philadelphia Eagles. House will solve the ailment. Well, I mean, that makes sense, right? The patient always gets worse before they get better.
That's true.
And so this was, maybe they found the actual cause of the illness, and it was Doug Peterson. Good job, Hugh Laurie, diagnosing the Philadelphia Eagles.
You did it again, Dr. House. All right, I'm still on the clock. I'm not taking Miles. This is where I will take Clyde. I'll take Clyde here. Clyde Edwards-Helaire.
Hugh Laurie? All right. You're taking Clyde Edwards-Helaire? Okay, I get it. I'm on the clock. I'm going to go with Mr. Still Disrespected. He was basically a top three back over the last part of the season.
I don't know what to do with this guy.
I didn't know what to do with him either, but this is the point in the draft where I'll say, you know what? Maybe he stays on the streak he was on. I'm going to take David Montgomery, who looked awesome in his second half of the sophomore year. Remember, he started the year with that groin injury. Maybe that slowed him down a little bit. But, at some point, you've got to take a guy who was that good, and this is the point for me. He was the running back 4 on the season.
I get it. I mean, those first 3 weeks, though, he was averaging 3 targets a game, and then you saw that jump all the way up to 5 targets a game. With the absence of Tariq Cohen, we'll see what they do. Yeah, they have a quarterback problem as well.
But like, let's compare. So James Robinson and David Montgomery, right? James Robinson was the guy and projects to be the guy next year, whereas David Montgomery was the guy, but we don't know if the passing work will go down. But David Montgomery finishes the running back four. He has capital invested in him. He is a centerpiece of that offense next year, we know for sure. Whereas James Robinson, who finished worse than him this year and has all these question marks, you know, that every time I kept going James Robinson versus this guy, I would always go with the other.
Yeah, that's super tough. Where are we at? So I took you took David Montgomery. All right.
Only four picks left. And there's so many guys I want drafted. Yes.
Okay, well, there's only four picks left. This one, we're back to this discussion of, is it the old vet or is it the new wily wide receiver? Is he actually the number one on the team? That's going to be a very fun conversation this entire offseason. And I'm siding right now. I'm taking the young gun. I'm going to take Calvin Ridley from the Atlanta Falcons. I'm going to draft him above Julio Jones. And if he doesn't like it, I don't care.
There is.
I'm taking Calvin.
There is 0.0% chance I would ever draft Julio over Calvin Ridley.
Really? You're that far over.
Absolutely. You know, another year older, more injuries, more leg issues, which has been a repeating theme for Julio for the last several years. And then the true breakout of Ridley. Ridley is the player I have slotted in here as well. So I would do the same as you. I think Ridley is the future. I don't want to be caught holding the bag. I want the future, not the past. All right, so this next spot.
You have two picks left, Jason.
I've got two picks. I know the two guys I want to draft, but I don't think I'm going to get either one of them because they're just outside these rankings.
Interesting.
I've got George Kittle here, but I don't want to draft George Kittle.
Do you have Kittle over Waller?
I do. Yeah, I've got Kittle over Waller. I'm not drafting another tight end. It's not going to be George Kittle here. I am going with J.K. Dobbins. J.K. Dobbins will be my pick here. I believe what we saw the end of this season is what the role he's going to inherit for one of the best running teams in the history of football.
Sure.
He's, you know, been a top 10 guy and he's only going to be better next year. So he should be locked and loaded as a safe pick that has hopeful high upside.
I will say this, looking at my rankings here, I was talking about two running backs, James Robinson, and I didn't name the other player. The other player was going to be J.K. Dobbins. And then I simply forgot about J.K. Dobbins because I would have drafted him where I took Clyde Edwards-Helaire. But that's how the draft goes. Sometimes you look at your sheet funny and it doesn't work. All right, next. Now you are at the point of the draft where you're hoping that your running back hits, but there are elite wide receivers like Julio, Keenan, Jefferson available on the
Metcalf
board.
AJ Brown.
Metcalf is much lower on the list for me. I am soured by the end of the season, and then you have the lemon squeeze on the wounds of saying like, yeah, but that's what we're gonna do next year. Metcalf will have incredible games, but I would rather get someone who's consistent like Justin Jefferson. I have Mike Evans ranked ahead of DK Metcalf right now. Okay. And that's where we are. So do you take the I'm just going to take the elite wide receiver. I'm going to take Keenan Allen here. I know. I'm taking the targets. I'm feeling good about it. I get Big Herb tied to me.
All right. So I'm taking the last pick. The last pick. And there are so many worthy options to get in, but I'm going to choose the player that I want to make this list. And that is Justin Jefferson. If you're talking about young superstar, you say I'm going to take the superstar wide receiver, and then you went Keenan, I'm thinking, I think it's Justin Jefferson. I mean, the dude was unfathomably good this year.
Yes.
He was a rookie, and I mean, he didn't even really participate in the first 2 weeks of the season that much. He certainly didn't make a big impact. I believe three targets in each of those first two games, but he finished the season as the wide receiver six. And I think he's, you know, he is only going to get better as a wide receiver. It doesn't mean he's going to be better than the wide receiver fantasy finish. But I can't see him finishing outside of the top 15 wide receivers. That sure seems impossible. So I'm going to make him the 24th player in our 2021 top 24 players.
All right. That is very fair. And then because I am in charge and his name just has to be on this list, even though he's not in my top 24, but pick number 25, just put him on here, Brooks. It's Antonio Gibson, everybody, from Washington. Just because I want him to be on there. And you see the reports, Jay?
I didn't.
Let's see if you remember. Off-season reports of a player's weight. Which direction do I like weight to go for wide receivers?
For wide receivers, you like more weight and less weight for running back.
That is 100% correct. I like when my running backs say they're going to slim down. Antonio Gibson, we're already in it, baby. The narrative, he's slimming down. He's going to maintain his speed and his strength, but he will be quicker. Oh, I am very excited next year for Antonio Gibson. I just really hope they find him a quarterback.
Yeah, that is the issue when I was ranking him, was just how much can I trust this Washington football team offense? Who knows? Maybe that's where Phillip Rivers ends up, you know? I mean,
sure. Man, I would take that. Those Phillip Rivers checkdowns.
Yeah, that would be excellent for the Gibbs season.
Do you have a name that you wanted to be on the list that didn't make it, or was that just Justin Jefferson? You got him in at the end.
It really was Justin Jefferson. I actually have AJ Brown one spot ahead of Justin Jefferson. So it was kind of weird, but when I look at that, Justin Jefferson deserves that spot, but AJ Brown would be the clear next name. I mean, all the dude has done in now two seasons is dominate every time he's on the field. He's probably going to be a great value this year because he missed that first chunk of the season, and that carries disproportional weight. Because right now, everybody listening to this podcast right now at the 1 hour mark in the fantasy football offseason, you know how good AJ Brown was, but there are so many people who check out when their team starts losing, check out certainly by this point, and what they remember is when they were in it, and that was the first month of the fantasy football season, and AJ Brown was a huge disappointment.
I don't disagree. That's going to wrap up our way too early top 24 rankings. Special thanks to Pristine Auction for helping us keep the lights on. Pristine Auction, the best sports memorabilia site of all time. And right now being auctioned, a Clyde Edwards-Helaire signed football that ends on Wednesday, a Dak Prescott signed Dallas Cowboys full-size authentic on-field speed helmet. And this is a Rookie of the Year signed helmet. That auction ends on Wednesday. And a Jerry Rice signed 49ers full-size authentic on-field Matt White speed helmet. That auction ends on Wednesday. Like I said, they have the absolute best stuff. And shout out to them. Speaking of the best, trying always taking things to 100, they redid all their logos and stuff. They did a rebrand.
It looks nice. I you know, you want, when you rebrand, you want to keep your feel, but
yep,
be more modern. I'm a big fan. I like it.
They did an excellent job. So we will see you. We will see you on Thursday
For an AMA.
Is that what we're doing?
That is what we're doing. Footballers AMA on Thursday. So look for social posts, submit questions anytime on the website. You can ask us anything. We'll answer all of your questions.
Absolutely. At the FF Ballers on Twitter, at Fantasy Footballers on Instagram. That is going to do it for today's show. Andy will be back for Thursday. If you want an extra episode reminder, check out the Spitballers podcasts. It's just a heck of a good time. All right, thanks everybody for tuning in. We'll see you on Thursday.
Thank you for listening to another episode of the Fantasy Footballers podcast. Join our fantasy football community on jointhefoot.com and follow us on Twitter @TheFFBallers.